Welcome to the Bondi Field Trip location. In this site, what we're going to see is sedimentary rock intruded by a volcanic neck and also intruded by dikes. We'll also see some of the effects of the heat of those intrusions on the host rock, the sedimentary rock around it. First of all, though, we should talk safety. Now, clearly here, we're on the edge of a cliff. So the last thing I want you to do, I don't want you to do at all, is to approach the cliff. You do not have to get near the cliff face to see things. You can stand back and observe them. We will also try and get some drone footage so we can actually show you some of the features of the cliff face in detail. So again, you don't have to go anywhere near the cliff face. Just inland from us is the golf course, and we're actually standing on part of it here. Please keep away from the golf course as much as possible. Please keep an eye out for golfers so we can get stray balls that may come across your path, as I've seen this morning by some expert golfers. The other thing, we're very exposed, so there's a lot of wind, the sun's on you, so please wear sunscreen, a hat, bring lots of water and some food so that you can do the job safely. The geology map that we looked at showed two main rock types. The first was the RH Hawkesbury sandstone that we viewed at a number of locations. And the other one is the JV, or the volcanic neck, and the associated dikes. The volcanic neck is a basalt, typically. In the background, in the cliff face, what we can see is typical Hawkesbury sandstone. Thick, continuous beds of sandstone divided up by long continuous bedding planes, roughly subhorizontal. Within each bed, we may see some patterns like cross bedding and also possibly joints breaking through one or two or three of those beds, but nowhere near as continuous as the bedding planes. We can also potentially see, when we're looking within the beds, some shale interbeds, as we saw on the geology map. We also may be able to see some horizontal igneous material. It's difficult to tell the difference between the shale and the igneous material, but where we've got the igneous material coming up and heading along a weakness plane that is a bedding plane, it will go horizontal. And so what we're looking at there is a sill, as opposed to a dike, which is vertical. A sill is horizontal. When we look at the igneous rock, which we can see just behind me, the intrusion, you see it's got quite a reddish color. That's the iron oxide, so it's extremely highly to extremely weathered. Around the outside of that igneous material, you may see a white to bluish green colored clay. So that's where the igneous material has completely weathered from being a rock to being a soil, or has soil-like properties. We may still see some of the structure of the rock, so we call that extremely weathered. On this side of the sandstone we observed, we have a roughly circular volcanic neck. The volcanic neck starts on the land side here, where the depression is, and then extends out over the sea. We can observe out over the sea one of the islands, which is a volcanic island. So it's very rough and irregular. That's because it's the volcanic material. It hasn't weathered as much as the material up here because it's covered by water most of the time. To the north of that volcanic island is another little island. You'll notice it's quite different. It's actually made up of blocks. And this is because that island is sandstone. So highly resistant to weathering and erosion. And generally its shape is governed by the joints, which we know are roughly parallel and perpendicular to the coast. So it makes this blocky shape. Looking at the igneous intrusion in detail, what we can typically see is a highly weathered material. So that's why we've got this reddish purple coloring. That's the iron oxide, particularly within the joints. So if we look at the joints, they've been filled up with this iron oxide material, and it's actually now more resistant to weathering, and the igneous material, the blocks in between the joints, are weathering away. We can also see some of the white, extremely weathered or residual material as well. So this is the step beyond this, where it's actually heading off to being of soil properties. The material itself, if you look carefully, you can notice where the larger visible crystals from the original igneous material as well. Behind me you see a large sort of columnar section of rock. This rock's quite unusual because we expected to see Hawkesbury sandstone, the big beds that I can see in the distance. Here though, it seems to be forming these columns, and that looks kind of like basalt columns from a volcanic flow. But we haven't had a volcanic flow here, and the rock's too light. If we look in detail at the rock, it's actually made up of little grains, quartz grains. So it's actually the sandstone, but it's been affected by the heat. So all in this area here, you can see that goes around that volcanic neck, the rock has been heated up and cooled. And the heating and cooling process has induced tensile stresses in the rock and created cooling joints, exactly like what we would see in basalt. So you see this columnar type features to the sandstone. Since the sandstone is no longer the same as before, it is a changed rock, then we've really got to call it a metamorphic rock. Now we know that Hawkesbury sandstone is a quartz-based sandstone, and so if it's a metamorphosed rock, the mineralogy doesn't change, it's still all quartz, so its name will become quartzite. So quartzite is the metamorphosed version of Hawkesbury sandstone or quartz sandstone. Okay, if we look at the quartzite in detail, what we can see is some of the relic Hawkesbury sandstone patterning as well as the cooling joints. So I can see here this pattern across the rock, which is the cross bedding that we've seen in ordinary Hawkesbury sandstone. The top of this exposure is subhorizontal, and that's the bedding plane. So that's the original bedding planes, we can still see those. What we're looking at here is one big bed of sandstone. The jointing that you see here, which is sort of orientated in this direction, are the cooling joints. So this is where we've heated up the sandstone, it's cooled, contracted, inducing tensile stresses in the rock, and so they fail forming joints or tensile joints. So they're our shrinkage joints, and that's telling us it's quartzite. This doesn't always happen near igneous intrusions. In fact, this is quite an extensive area, but you do find it occasionally around the Sydney area near dikes or intrusions. So the geology map shows us that there are dikes in the area, one running parallel to the coast and three running perpendicular to the coast. What you can see behind me is the trace of the dike running parallel to the coast. If you go and have a look at the discussion we had about Long Reef, you'll see that the dike there actually sticks above the rock platform. And that's because the dike material is weathering slower than the claystone around it. At this location, and in most locations where you see Hawkesbury sandstone and dikes, the Hawkesbury sandstone is quartz-based, it's silica, very resistant to weathering and erosion. And so what we usually find is that the dike weathers first. In this case, the dike has weathered completely to soil and then has been eroded. So all we're left with is a slot where the dike used to be. If you went down to sea level or below, and don't do that, but if you did, you would probably find weathered dike material at the bottom of these gullies. The dike itself is originally igneous material, so what's happened is the igneous material has forced its way up through the joints in the Hawkesbury sandstone, the weakness paths. And so that's why it forms this wall of rock. The magma comes up, cools down, becomes basalt. So the major joint sets in Sydney are parallel to the coast, perpendicular to the coast. That's why we find the dikes on that orientation. You'll notice here that there's been failures as well. So columns of rock have fallen into the sea off that dike face. There's still some of the columns left, and probably with time, geological time, those two will also fall into the sea, particularly with the erosion from the waves undercutting that column of rock. It probably extends back and between those buildings and the swimming pools, so probably don't go swimming there if you're invited. Thanks for ducking golf balls with me at North Bondi. I hope you enjoyed what you've seen and you'll get something out of it for when you come here. Just remember, if you do come here, keep well away from the edges. There's a steep drop off, so I don't want you anywhere near them. We had some fun today flying drones just so you can get a bit of a better overview and not have to approach the faces. Just after you leave here, head down to the northern point of Bondi Beach where you find Mermaid Rock. As you walk down to Mermaid Rock, just look under the overhangs, and that's where the shale breccia is if you're looking for it. Remember that the pumice is the stuff you find on the sands, and it will float, so it's really light, but you may not find it at all if there hasn't been the right winds and volcanic eruptions in the Pacific. So I'll see you back at campus. Good luck.